Welcome to Movie Friends. We are your hosts, Seth and Michelle, and today we are talking about This Is Spinal Tap from 1984. Directed by Rob Reiner, cinematography by Peter Smokler, written by Harry Shearer, Rob Reiner, Michael McKean, and Christopher Guest, edited by Kent Beta and Kim Sechrist, starring Christopher Guest, Michael McKean, Harry Shearer, June Chadwick, and Rob Reiner. Michelle, how are you?
I'm good, Seth. You read Harry Shearer so well. I always stumble over his last name because I always want to be like, Harry Shearer.
Harry Shearer.
Right. And he deserves to have his full last name read correctly.
Have you ever noticed how his name is a joke? Because, you know, it's a Shearer.
And he's Harry.
Which is cutting hair. And he's Harry. He's Harry Shearer. Isn't that great?
Oh, my God. Never, ever noticed that.
I never noticed it until just now.
Wow. We're off to a great start.
Well, we are. Listener, we're off to a horrible start, actually. We've had like a strain of technical difficulties. It's pretty wild. But, you know, it's put me in the mood to talk about a band who had a string of technical difficulties.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
But before we do that, we got some emails.
Wow. I can't wait to hear what the people are saying.
We got a few. I will just say we did get one from Ben.
Of course.
We're not going to read it. I just want to let you know that he is alive. I know.
Ben, that doesn't mean to stop writing.
Correct. All right. So the first email is from Betsy.
Betsy, yes.
She says, hi, Seth and Michelle. Responding to your episode on The Producers.
Oh, no. Oh, God.
Michelle's face just went, ooh.
I'm just going to exit out of here.
You asked for celebrity stories. I did housekeeping one summer, and the Black Crows stayed in the hotel. This was at the time Kate Hudson was married to the lead singer, and she was also there. I'm a polite person who would greet guests in the hallway, and when I said good morning to her, she gave me a stink face and kept walking.
Whoa.
Not cool, Kate Hudson.
Not cool, but maybe she doesn't smile before coffee.
Oh, is that a rule?
Maybe it's her rule. I don't know. I try to give people the benefit of the doubt, you know?
Okay.
Like, we don't know what they're going through, and maybe Kate really needed her coffee.
It's possible.
Awesome. Or green juice, hey, whatever you're into. Pick your morning poison. Yeah.
Yeah. She says, to bring it back to Larry David, there is actually a Seinfeld connection in this movie. The actor who plays Jerry's dad is one of the German generals in the show.
Oh, my gosh.
I love this silly movie. Thanks for covering it.
Aw, thanks, Betsy. Also, I don't want to defend Kate because, Betsy, you deserve smiles and waves.
Definitely.
Yeah. Okay. Just had to get that out there. Because, you know, I would have stressed about that and texted Seth at like 2 a.m. and be like, Betsy's going to think I'm defending Kate Hudson.
You're choosing Kate Hudson over Betsy?
Yeah. And never, ever would I do that.
I'm wondering what scenario I would pick Kate Hudson over Betsy. Like softball. You know what I mean? It's like pick who for your team. And I'm down to Kate Hudson and Betsy.
You're picking Betsy.
You think
How
so?
Is this even a... No, you pick Betsy. Always pick Betsy.
Okay. All right.
We should make that a bumper sticker. Always pick Betsy.
We got another email from my sister Elizabeth, who I told the story about how we went to go see Newsies together.
Yeah.
So she wrote an email, and it is long. And she starts out by saying, this email is so long, please feel free to cut as needed if it gets read on an episode. Before I start my novella about Newsies, my husband Jacob and I have been watching along with many of the movies you all have covered, and I have to say, the worst you've covered was Hereditary. It took us 3 separate viewings to finish it. It was so terrifying that I kept being thankful you didn't make Mitch Ruby watch this. That would have been the end of your movie friendship.
Thank you, Elizabeth.
Yeah, I did that episode with my wife, and over on patreon.com/moviefriendspodcast, I do a whole series of movies that are the worst movies that we would cover on this show. Yeah, it's a lot of fun.
Yeah, I think that's where the fun's happening.
We did The Witch. We did Texas Chainsaw Massacre. For Christmas, we're doing Eyes Wide Shut and Black Christmas. It's great. Ooh, it's a good time.
Nice.
Anyways, Newsies is perfect. I absolutely loved hearing Maria's experiences because 100% my sister Tori and I were living the same life. Tori and I would literally sit on our top bunk for hours, rehearsing each song, and would correct each other if we missed or forgot a word until we knew it by heart. I've been watching this movie on repeat since you announced it would be the next episode, and it may be my rose-colored glasses, but I wouldn't change a thing. This is the only movie I haven't made my husband watch because I am not emotionally prepared for any form of criticism he may have. Jacob breaks Seth's guarantee that any homeschooler loved/loves Newsies. He might be disqualified from that because he saw it for the first time at 19, so maybe his brain was too developed to be infected with the bug.
Yeah, I think so.
Newsies is the only Broadway show I've ever seen. No regrets. Seth made us leave at the closing act while people were still clapping because he didn't want to get trapped by everyone exiting the theater and made me run/jog to Penn Station, St. Patrick's Day in New York City as a teenager in the dark. Trying to keep up with grown-up Seth and trying to catch the LIRR was more memorable than the show.
Wow. Thank you, Elizabeth. I love how much this movie is intertwined in your family. Do you think this is the movie of the VAR guys?
No, there's other movies. Oh. But this is one of them, for sure.
Yeah, yeah.
She also says, I still do the Pulitzer counting sound whenever I have to calculate in front of someone. Then she says, Seth, the fact that a New Yorker butchered a New York accent is inexcusable. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Thanks, Elizabeth. Hey, if you guys want to be like Betsy and Elizabeth and always have us pick you, send us an email, moviefriendspodcast@gmail.com. We'd love to hear from you.
We love it.
Also, this is the last week to enter into our review giveaway. December 1st is coming, man. Isn't that crazy? So this is it, guys.
Oh, my God.
Stop whatever you're doing right now. Go over to Apple Podcasts and give us a rating and a review.
Seth, how excited are you that this is coming to an end and you don't have to keep saying Apple Podcasts? I know. Although we're going to keep asking for reviews because it helps the show.
I'm going to make you do it.
I'll do it. It rolls right off the tongue with me, yeah. Apple Podcasts. And every week Seth's like,
Apple Podcast. That's what I'm thinking of. Ooh. Tomorrow's Thanksgiving. We're recording this the night before Thanksgiving.
We sure are. Thanksgiving Eve.
Yeah, not as big of a holiday, but
I think
be.
With people in their 20s, they used to go out to the bars.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. You come home from college and you.
Yeah. I never did that, but I heard the townsfolk would do it.
Correct. Yeah. Townsfolk.
I don't know.
You could hear them having fun from your window.
That's right. I hear the clogging in the streets.
Are having fun.
There they go with their beers.
Also, quick reminder, our live show in January is fast approaching. Gotta make your travel plans now. January 13th, Albany, New York. Come out. It's gonna be cool. Anyway, enough of this nonsense. Before Michelle watches a film for the first time, she records her pre-watch thoughts. So let's go to that real quick.
Y'all, this is the seventh time of me trying to do a pre-watch thought. Normally, I record it real quick right before I'm about to watch a boot. Wow. I'm not going to hit stop, so I'm not doing this again. Words are hard, and I can't get out my thoughts. Anyway, Spinal Tap. This is Spinal Tap. I had no idea that this movie had a longer title. Clearly, I've never really thought about it. Truly, when I do think about it, though, for some reason, I thought this was a movie that was more serious, that was just called Spinal Tap, like I said, and was directed by Spike Lee. Don't ask me how I got there. I have no idea. And also, if we pull back the curtain, last week, what you guys don't know, is at the end of Newsies, Seth and I went back and forth for about 20 minutes of what we were going to do for the last movie of the month. It was between Blues Brothers and Spinal Tap. I've never seen either. Obviously, I was really pushing for Blues Brothers. Seth has his thoughts. I don't know if he'll share or if he'll save it. But I was like, let's pull out to our patrons. And so I pulled out in the Discord. We gave it like a minute or two and Cosmo came through. So really, we're doing This Is Spinal Tap for Cosmo.
Okay, so I have three points, three questions for you.
Oh, God.
One.
Yeah.
You thought this was a serious movie?
Well, aren't spinal taps painful?
Yes, absolutely. But you had like no history with this.
Nothing.
Wow.
I've heard about it, yeah. But I thought it was a serious movie directed by Spike Lee. Right. I don't ask me why, how, and I never thought to like research it on my own to figure out, because I was like in my head, I'm like, oh, serious movie, Spike Lee, Spinal Tap.
Got it. I would love to see Spinal Tap as directed by Spike Lee.
Right.
Second, wow for outing me for not doing Blues Brothers, but huge shout out to Cosmo for coming in clutch.
Mm-hmm. I thought when it was important.
We need to hear most.
I thought it was important that your voice matters.
That's right. Absolutely.
The Patreon voice matters. But yeah, I mean, we spent like 25 minutes, Seth, discussing it.
Yeah.
So I think people should know.
That's the power of editing. You wouldn't know at all if you listened to that episode.
Nope.
I just go, okay, and the movie for next week. And then there was a 20-minute conversation. And then I come back in and say, it's Spinal Tap.
I'm like, wow, really?
Yeah. And then the last thing is ad-libbing that pre-watch thought. You know, you were saying you were having difficulty. You said a boot.
I said a boot. Yeah.
Does that make you appreciate that this entire movie was improvised?
I guess so. Now, learning that.
Did you know that this entire movie was improvised?
No.
Oh, okay. Wow, you really have no experience.
So, like, told
movie.
You this is Spinal Tap, serious movie directed by Spike Lee.
That's great. That's really great. Okay.
Wow. And you asked me, you were like, oh, have you seen Best in Show?
Yes. Yep.
And I said, no, but I want to. And Ant has, we've always talked about watching that. He's like, I think you'd really be into it. And I was like, yes. Yeah.
You guys love animals, and like as animal people, you will appreciate it probably more than I do, but it's wonderful.
But if it's like the same vein of this, then yes.
All right, cool. So yeah, my first question for you was like, is this your first Christopher Guest? Even though this is directed by Rob Reiner and the other ones would go on to be directed by Christopher Guest. So this is your first kind of experience with like his mockumentaries.
I believe so. Can you name a couple and I'll tell you if I have heard of them or I've seen them?
So For Your Consideration.
I have heard of that.
Waiting for Guffman.
Heard of that.
Best in Show.
Right.
A Mighty Wind.
Heard of that. Okay. So I've heard of these. But let it be known, though, I didn't think any of those were serious or directed by Spike Lee.
Okay.
I just want to make that point.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Wow, so you didn't... Oh, man, this is very cool then. All right, I'm excited. I'm, like, re-excited.
Okay, good. I'm glad you're re-excited. Yeah.
Yeah, so the whole thing is born out of, like, a live skit that they did. And they... I don't know if they had, like, technical issues or whatever. They had to improvise a lot. And so when it was over, they were like, we should do something with this kind of a thing. They shot, like, a 20-minute little short... And then from there, went on to make the whole thing. But I've seen that this had a 4-page treatment to a 12-page script total for the entire movie. And some of the jokes had to be pre-done. You know, amplifiers going up to 11 and Stonehenge. You can't fully improvise those things.
Right.
But for the most part. In fact, that's why all the performers have... writing credits because so much was improvised, but they tried to get writing credits for like all the performers, like Fran Drescher, and because it was all just improvised.
Wow.
Yeah.
This changes my rating.
Wow. Okay. All right.
Which I'll reveal at the end, but.
Sure.
Wow. Okay.
Speaking of Fran Drescher. We just did, again, for our Patreon show, Super Amazing Film Club, we did UHF, the Weird Al movie, and she was in that, and now we're recording on Fran Drescher twice in 1 week.
What a delight. Like, truly a gift for us.
Yeah.
I mean, I love Fran Drescher, and I think she's fantastic in both movies.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I love her in this. I love... just you know, whenever I write my notes, I always say, I'm like, it's so hard to just not write down every single line. And like so yeah. much of this, I was like, am I just writing everything down?
You're transcribing it.
Pretty much. Pretty yeah. much. Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, I love her when she... when she's like, what was the White Album? There was nothing on that album.
Yeah.
And I think that that puts it kind of into Ian's mind to then do, you know, the Black Album.
Right, right. It's so shiny. You can see a reflection in it.
Yeah. So yeah. while this movie was improvised, the band members are actually playing their instruments. I don't know if you knew that nope. either.
I did not know that. Oh, wow. So, okay, here's the thing, right? I looked for a couple of podcasts to mm-hmm. like kind of get some information on this, and nothing was good. So I just want to tell you, I think we're going to make a real good Spinal Tap episode.
Woohoo!
I must have filtered through like 3 podcasts, nothing. It was a bunch of like back and forth banter, and I'm like, you know, their listeners probably love hearing them, but like, give me some Spinal Tap, you know, trivia and stuff. So I did right. a little of my own research, but mostly it was like, let me just get actors right and names. And so I didn't dig too much. I didn't yeah. dig too much. I was like, Seth will tell me. He'll teach yeah. me.
Yeah. yeah. And honestly, there's not tons and tons of info.
Right. Well, that was the, yeah. I mean, I kept coming up to like the same things. And honestly, yeah. the thing I saw the most was Spinal Tap 2.
Yeah.
And I was like, what? There's a second one?
There is. And there's a third one that's like in the works right now.
No.
So these guys have continued as Spinal Tap in various forms. I sent you earlier today, they were on The Simpsons.
Yeah.
As yep. Spinal Tap, though.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And of course, Harry Shearer.
Yeah.
You know, the man with a name. The man with a joke name.
Yeah.
He does so many voices on mm-hmm. The Simpsons. But they have put out albums as Spinal Tap. They've done concerts as Spinal Tap. Various media appearances. And yeah, they're working on a third one.
Have you seen the second one?
Yeah, a long time ago. Yeah, okay, it's okay. short. It's not like a whole full movie.
Yeah. Yeah. yeah.
And Criterion did have this. I think it's like out of print now. There's this whole weird thing with Criterion where like they had initially put things out on like Laserdisc or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And are those part of like the full collection? Because they've never been re-released. And like Spinal Tap is kind of like in that weird zone. Mm. DVDs of this go on sale for like $250, $300 on eBay.
Whoa.
Yeah. Wow. But they all do, they do the commentary track as the characters.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
I feel so, like I really, this is a movie, you can't really absorb everything on the first time.
Definitely not.
Especially
definitely
if you didn't know not. What you were getting into. So, yeah.
There were a lot of things that I noticed. I watched this about two and a half times for this. Yeah. And yeah, transcribing everything definitely helps. Like the whole comment about the White Album,
mm-hmm.
you yep. know, and then turning Smell the Glove into the Black Album. I was like, okay, I never put that connection together. I also never thought about how Nigel's faux pas with not knowing the difference between inches and feet when he draws Stonehenge.
Yes.
That's a funny joke, but it doesn't make any sense because they're from the UK. They don't use inches and feet.
No.
And so I was like, I wonder if anyone has ever picked up on that before. And then I was like, of course they have. Come on.
Right.
Yeah. But then I thought, wait, but then whatever they use in the UK, do they also use the 1 dash or 2 dashes? You know what I mean?
I do.
Meters.
Yeah. Let's ask Dom and Simon.
Millimeters.
When we have them on.
Yeah, let's do it.
They're my representatives for the UK. So I go to them for everything.
So then I was like, oh, maybe I didn't notice something that I thought was a smart catch. Maybe I'm an idiot.
Right.
But no, I don't think you can grasp it. And there are some things that you might like see, but you don't like perceive fully. Mm-hmm. Like, for example, at one point, like all the members of the band have cold sores.
I wrote that down. I said, oh my God, do these boys all have lip herpes?
Yeah.
Amazing. This was
a deleted plot line was that they had like an opening band. It was like an all female opening band. And that like they all had slept with the lead singer or something.
Yeah. And honestly, to get rid of that scene, it's fine. It works without it.
Well, yeah, it just makes it like it.
This made, to me, I was like, oh my God, they all have lip herpes. That's so funny.
Yeah.
That's so funny.
Another thing is Nigel's Gumby. I don't know if you've noticed any. He wears a Gumby shirt several times throughout the film. He also, in two scenes, he has a little Gumby riding out of his pocket.
No way.
And it's just never brought up or mentioned. And apparently, like, that's part of the. They shot, now, you know, how can we verify all of this stuff? It's hard to know, especially when the people telling this story are the performers who are telling the story as themselves. And,
right.
But because this was improvised, apparently they have like 100 hours of footage of just them like doing interviews and like, yeah.
Are there bloopers?
I haven't seen any.
Yeah.
But another thing that you'll see mentioned a lot is like that there's supposedly like a 4.5 hour cut.
I believe it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, definitely you get everyone in a room, you do a scene, you could record for 2.5 hours easy.
Right.
Just on one scene.
Oh yeah.
And I think like having that amount of footage helps make, to me, almost every line in this movie be very, very funny.
Very funny.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it feels, because it's in the documentary style.
Yeah.
It feels real. And so you don't have a, like, obviously you have to edit and tell the story, but like if things seem kind of out of place or we're cutting weirdly, it's like, oh no, this makes sense because it's a documentary and that's just what we're capturing. Yeah.
You had texted me that you were going to pause watching it because of an arm movement. You said Anthony is going to love this movie because of an arm movement or something like that. Can you explain that?
Yeah. Right in the beginning, we have Rob Reiner explaining Spinal Tap.
Yeah. Marty DeBurgi, which is a combination of four directors' names.
Oh, is that so?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Marty Scorsese.
Okay. All right.
De Palma, Fellini. I can't remember all of them. I'll look it up.
Okay. But good to know. That's funny. And so the camera's following him and he's standing and we get a wide shot of him and he goes to like fold his arms and then like loosely drops them because he doesn't know what to do and I died.
Yes. Yeah.
This broke me and we're 2 minutes in, if that, a minute and 30. And I was like, you know what? I'm going to see if Ant wants to watch this. So
that is something that I took notice of every time I watched it because Marty's character, he starts off by being like, oh, I've done a bunch of commercials.
Right.
And so he's not, I don't want to say like he's not a filmmaker, but this is kind of his foray into like this world. And Scorsese had done The Last Waltz, which was this big concert movie / interviews where he is in it, you know, because a lot of times in documentaries, we're not seeing the voice asking the questions is not there. We just hear the answers. And it was with the band.
Mm-hmm.
Good documentary. Especially if you like the band.
Mm-hmm.
And supposedly he was upset because he was like, you have this director called Marty who's like out of his depth making this rock documentary. You're making this about me. And yeah, but he's supposedly come around on, yeah. So Marty DiBurgi is Martin Scorsese, Brian De Palma, Steven Spielberg, and either Fellini or Antonioni.
Got it.
Yeah, pretty funny.
Yeah, but the arm movement was so subtle. I was like, this is so funny. I rewound it and watched it by myself. And then I was like, wait, Ant. And so I had high hopes for Ant to watch this with me. And he kind of did. I mean, he was on his phone most of the time. But he got a good chuckle of the arm movement.
There's a lot of stuff in this that's hitting you over the head. I mean, like, Stonehenge, I think, like, the pod that won't open. There's a lot of stuff that's just like, hey. But then there, some of my favorite stuff is just the stuff that's so subtly funny. Yeah. Like, later in the film, after Ian quits and Janine takes over, they're in an airport and she's handing everyone their tickets and their itineraries. And Nigel's just sitting there wearing the craziest cowboy hat you've ever seen. And just nobody mentions it. And I'm just dying. And everything that he does, I don't think he says a single word in that scene. Yeah. Because he's like, he's kind of like throwing a fit. You know, him and Janine don't get together.
Right.
At one point, she's like, Nigel, you need one. And they're like, yeah, Nigel. And he just slowly like lifts his up. Like he does have his itinerary. And they're like, oh, he's got his. Just like, oh my God. It's great.
Yeah.
I personally avoided this movie for years. And like, we're going to hear from our good friend Felicia later on about her own experience with this type of thing. But
yeah,
I avoided this movie for a long time because growing up, the most annoying people that I knew were massive fans of Spinal Tap. And they're like, it's the funniest movie ever. And in my mind, I was just like, well, you're not funny. So it must be not funny at all. I didn't watch this for a long, long time. And then I don't know what it, I guess it was watching Christopher Guest's other stuff. Because I think I saw Best in Show first, and I was just like, this is the most Polly Parker, right?
I don't know what you're talking about.
The actress?
Polly Parker?
No, Polly Parker.
Polly Parker makes me think of Polly Pocket. So.
I know. I'm not thinking Best in Show. Parker Posey.
Parker Posey, our girl.
Polly Parker. Okay. Parker Posey's in that. And it's just, it totally like melted my brain when I saw it. And so I watched all of his other stuff. And I think I watched Spinal Tap last and was just totally like, oh, I made a huge mistake. Like this movie is actually really, really funny.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad you had the experience of after revisiting and kind of coming to terms with it. And you're like, okay, this is good. Like,
oh, yeah. And I understood.
This is funny.
Yeah. And like, that's such a silly thing that I used to do is like, I would associate certain media with people. And so I'd be like, well,
we all did it. Yeah. I mean, I've done that. We all do that.
Yeah. So,
but especially if you don't think they're funny and their usual humor is not good, you're like, oh, I'm not trusting you. Like, right. You're into that. We're not going to find the same thing funny.
There's something, and like, I find myself like really resisting doing this on this show is like, there's something like context is so important to humor. If you just say a joke, it's not that funny. Right. You know what I mean? Like in the context of this, you and I just watched it. The people listening, it's a movie that they've seen before, which is why it drives me crazy when people listen to this without watching. But it's like you get it, you know. But just never having seen the movie and hearing a bunch of like young teenage boys who are like really into Metallica be like, oh, Stonehenge, oh, 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 oh. I was like, all right, Stonehenge isn't funny, okay?
Right.
It's a very serious place.
Seth comes in.
Have you ever been to Stonehenge?
No, it was actually one of the places we thought we would go to while we were in England. But
is it in England? I don't know.
You can take a
And I have no idea where it is.
Yeah, and you can do like a day trip, but we just didn't have time. But it's on the list for next time.
Okay, let's. If you told me that Stonehenge was in Spain, I'd be like, sure, yeah.
Yeah, it's in England. I thought
to so. To me, Stonehenge is like an island in the middle of the ocean. And
what?
There's just this these rock monuments around, and it's like a magic place.
Okay. Wow.
Like, nobody lives at Stonehenge, do they?
I don't know much about it. It's just a historical landmark.
Well, the Druids, nobody knows where they came from or what they were doing. Yeah. So this month, you know, we've been talking about different things to do with music, and then we did Newsies. And I realized, like, the kind of cohesive thought that I'm totally just pulling out of my butt right now is about how the people who are in charge of, like, entertainment or even, like, newspapers are either, like, evil or incredibly stupid or both, a mixture of both. And Spinal Tap is, like, everyone around them is just nice to them and, like, oh, that's so great and, oh, this and that. Meanwhile, they're, like, the dumbest people on the planet.
Do you think they sound good?
I do. Some songs, yes. But right, it's hard to say because the lyrics are so ridiculous.
Well, that's what I'm saying, right? Like, if you were listening, you're like, all right, I get it. And then you, like, really tune in and you're like, wait, what? Oh, my lucky bun day?
Okay.
Wait, what did you just say?
Starting out with, tonight, we're going to rock you tonight. That, like, musically, great. I think it's great. Like, the, like, ding, ding, ding,
bang, right.
Ding, bang, bang, bang. I think that that's good. And again, like, they're all very talented musicians. They do all of their own instruments in this. Like, Harry Shearer is, like, tearing apart the bass in this movie.
They're all great.
Yeah.
You never want to be a drummer, though, for Spinal Tap. No. And that was such, like, a funny joke that just continued. And it wasn't a joke, but it just continued as it went on. And you're like, oh.
Yeah.
We don't want to be the drummer.
Yeah. So I asked, I did a poll on Twitter.
Yeah.
That ended right before we started recording.
Yeah.
And I said, do you believe in spontaneous combustion? Yes or no? This is important.
Uh-huh.
57% said no, but 43% said yes. One person said, yes, someone that we know died of it. And I said, don't lie to me. And they said, I'm not lying. It was ruled spontaneous combustion.
What?
I'm just telling you. I'm just telling you what the people are saying.
We're going to need more info.
I agree. I want to know if I could spontaneously combust.
Wow, this just took a weird shift. Tonal change.
One of my favorite lines is, it was the type of thing the authorities said, better left unsolved. He died in a bizarre gardening accident.
Oh, he choked on someone else's vomit.
Yep. Yeah. He choked on vomit. Well, it was someone else's vomit.
Someone else's vomit.
Yeah. It's hard to tell who. Right. Well, you can't dust for vomit. And so, yeah, if you have 100 hours, you can cut it down to, I mean, what is it? 82 minutes, I think this is?
Yeah,
I think right? So. Like, just over 70? That's,
yeah.
It kind of makes it make more sense of, like, yeah, we're pulling just, like, the funniest stuff. Even though I'm sure there's a lot of other really funny things in there. But so the story of Spinal Tap is a band that was popular, probably not the most popular in the world. And then they've just been kind of slowly declining. And this is their last U.S. tour. And things start out good. Like, their first show starts out fine. And then they just keep having all these, like, technical issues, money issues. Shows are getting canceled. Events are not going well. And it leads to a breakup.
Yeah. But then, Japan.
Yeah. I wanted to ask you, like, I know that you were in a band with Krista.
Keep on rocking, dude.
Yeah. But beyond that, did any of this resonate with you just as, like, a creative person doing things with other creative people?
Ooh, what a great question. Not really, no. And I think because I didn't take the band seriously. Like, I think if I was, like, in a band, this would have made me think of that. You know, I was a drummer for, like, 2 days.
Yeah.
And keep on rocking, dude. And chord.
Right.
not to say, but I love this perspective you're bringing. Because I love collaborating with others. That's like my favorite thing. Well, that's what I'm saying.
Like, yeah. I know that you do a lot of things in different, you know. And
yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
I think that creative types can kind of do a lot of different things. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I mean, this movie, it made me really nostalgic for making movies with my friends when I was growing up. And have you seen our mockumentary, Ridiculous, What You Don't Know About the Porn Industry?
No. No.
It's so good.
I haven't seen that. No.
It's something I am so proud of. And it's like a series of trailers.
Do you have it?
I have to see if Nick has it. And it has all of our friends in it. And Nick and I, like, we wrote it. And then a lot of it is improv. And
oh my gosh, you made like Spinal Tap.
I did. Yeah. So this reminded me of that. And it also reminded me, which I sent you, Tragedy, the all metal tribute band to the Bee Gees.
Yes, and I've been listening to Tragedy for
they're
the last
pretty
few
great,
days.
Right? Yeah, they're really great. Yeah. We saw them opening for Passion Pit. And
whoa.
I know. Yeah. Passion Pit live was a snooze.
Oh.
When we saw them. Yes, Passionless Pit. But Tragedy opened for them and we were like, "Who is this?" This is probably like 14 years ago.
Okay.
And then we're like, Aunt and I became obsessed with Tragedy, and then we went and saw them, and it is wild. It reminded me of like what Spinal Tap.
Right.
It's like so over the top. Like, Aunt, like, I think it was like the guitar, no, maybe it was the singer's balls. Like, he wore like a banana hammock, just thrusted his balls in Aunt's face. Like, it was fantastic.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. Tragedy. Guys, you gotta go listen to Tragedy.
Well, that's why Spinal Tap has an audience of mostly young boys, because they frighten the females.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. But for you, you were in bands and you made music with people. So did you feel that way watching this?
Yeah. Oh, definitely. And like, you know, okay, so there's a story. When you two got inducted into the Hall of Fame, Rock Hall of Fame, The Edge said that when he saw Spinal Tap, he cried.
Oh, no.
Because he was like, it's very true to real life. And he was like, you know, you don't want to become like a parody of yourself. And there's like a scene towards the end between David and Derek where Derek is like, hey, we should be glad that we did this. We did this for like 15 years. We don't want to be way too old, you know.
Yeah.
So people should be envious of us. And he says, I'm envious of us. And it's kind of like a nice little thing. But yeah, so The Edge was like, yeah, I wept when I watched Spinal Tap. And Ozzy Osbourne says that when he watched it for the first time, he thought it was real. He didn't know that it wasn't, you know, which I mean, going back to 1984, Ozzy Osbourne, I'm not sure how lucid is, you know, right.
Right.
But yeah, people who have played music for their entire lives, unlike me, say like, yeah, this is pretty, you know, some things are like, seems like it actually kind of really happened. One band, I can't remember who it was, thought that it was like making fun of them because so many of the things were like directly from what had happened to them.
So that was one of my questions for you. Is Spinal Tap kind of a conglomerate, like based off of a lot of different bands inspired by,
you know,
like Metallica,
them,
I would
right.
think.
Well,
right?
Metallica, it's interesting you bring that up. Metallica, like, did Spinal Tap in reverse. Like, after Spinal Tap comes out, they literally released the Black Album, which was just a black album. Several parts of the story are all things that, like, including, like, the recurring, like, the drummers leaving, and, like, that was, like, their bass player, and I think James Hetfield recorded with the orchestra that David Steinhoven says that he wants to record with. It's really weird. Mm-hmm. Really, really weird. But according to them, they said, we didn't set out to make a funny movie. We just were like, let's make a fake rock documentary and it will be funny because we are funny. You know, being musicians themselves, it's not like they were like, hey, let's learn to play music for Spinal Tap. Like, they certainly would have been clued into different things around them. But
yeah.
According to them, it is not intended to be all one band.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. I want to ask you about the three main members of the band.
Yes.
I want to start with Derek Smalls.
Yes.
Harry Shearer as the bass player. Derek yes. Smalls. How'd you feel about him?
I loved his bangs. Okay, here's the thing. They all have bangs, but
yeah.
Derek, to me, I was able to keep his name straight to his face.
Okay.
Like Nigel and David, I kept confusing the two.
Got it. Okay.
Like I was like, Nigel, David, like I kept, like even in my notes, like I'm pretty sure I screwed up.
Yeah.
Who said what?
Yeah.
I felt like Nigel and David were more prominent than Derek.
Definitely. Yeah.
Yeah.
He says at the end, towards the end, he's like, they're like fire and ice, and right. I'm in the middle, lukewarm right. water.
Yeah. I mean, he's great. They all are great. But the other two, for me, made more of an impression.
Yeah.
Yeah. How do you feel?
I think he's great. I mean, Harry Shearer, I think he is like in the background a lot.
Yeah. Yeah.
He really does kind of stick to that, like, hey, let's all keep it together kind of a thing. Like when they're all melting down over Stonehenge, he's like, can I ask a practical question now? Are we doing Stonehenge tomorrow night?
Yes. Yes.
But yeah. Yeah. I think he's great. What did you think about Michael McKean as David St. Hubbins?
Oh, David.
Wait, can I ask you a question really quick?
Yeah.
For Michael McKean, are you just going from seeing him in like Better Call Saul to this?
I never saw Better Call Saul.
Oh, you didn't? Oh,
no.
Okay. Never mind.
But Michael McKean, I have seen him in other things.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. But David probably, oh gosh, David. David, there's the scene with the gum.
Yes.
And the two of them get into it of why you're holding the gum on your finger. And he's like, yeah. I can't put it on the table because, yeah. you know, that was fantastic. And I wrote in my notes that it was David, but maybe it was Nigel with the bread.
Nigel. Yeah. Nigel. Okay. Nigel so Nigel
the, is
red
the blonde.
Hair. No, right? No. Nigel is red hair. Red hair lead guitar player. David is blonde.
No.
With Janine. Yeah.
Oh my God. Well, color me embarrassed. I even, Seth, I have a picture of the three of them.
Yeah.
I'm looking at them right now.
Yeah. Nigel. Yeah. Nigel Tufnell.
No, I know.
It's like the most British name.
I read. Ever. Okay. So what I did read is they came up with that name to come up with like a really, it was like kind of inspired by Eric Clapton. And to just pick like a really dull first name and a boring place.
Got
and so
it.
They came up with that. But anyway, wow. Oh, well. Michelle, do better research. And I was like, I'm going to have a picture of them with their names underneath it. And I guess I have the wrong order.
That's pretty funny.
That is really funny. So tell me, like, what did you think about these two?
David, he definitely seems like the leader of the band, or he's at least the most like outgoing.
Yeah.
And, you know, definitely the storyline becomes like a Yoko storyline,
yeah.
which I'm not like a super big fan of. I do think June Chadwick as Janine, I think that she does a good job.
Yeah.
It's just kind of like, all right, you know, it's kind of a bummer that like the only lead female in this movie is like, you know, seen as, but okay, whatever. But David definitely seems like, yeah, like he's like the leader and he's the most outgoing. And I understand what it's like to like have a best friend for years and years and years. And like through all these like permutations of who you are and like your relationship. And that was something that I thought was really funny was they keep showing Spinal Tap like throughout the years playing like different musical styles. I loved Cups and Cakes. That's the one that they play over the radio.
And then the originals and the new originals.
Yeah.
And then back to the originals.
Yeah. Nigel is definitely my favorite. And I think he just has the funniest lines.
Okay, wait. Which one is Nigel? What color hair?
Red hair. So lead guitar player.
See, in this. Okay. Okay. Which hairstyle would you prefer?
Oh, God. None of them.
No, you have to pick. You have to pick.
I guess I would do David because, like, Nigel has, like, his hair is coming, like, off the back of his. It's, like, pointing up. It's so odd. I don't know. None of them look very good.
No, they look just so itchy.
Yeah.
And hot and sweaty.
These guys, they're not, like, good guys. They're clearly very sexist.
Yeah.
Over the credits. You watched the credits, right?
I did.
The credits.
Oh, my God, the credits.
Marty asks them, like, so your audience is predominantly white. So how do you feel about people? Like, do you feel like it's, like, racist? And they're like, oh, no, we're not racist at all. Like, we say, love your brother. Well, we don't literally say that. And Nigel says, we don't literally mean that either. But, you know, we're the furthest thing from racist. And then the whole big thing with the album is that the cover is sexist, right? It's demeaning to women.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And when Ian tells them they're not going to release the album because the cover is sexist, Nigel says, well, so what? What's wrong with being sexy? So not good guys. You know what I mean?
Right. Right.
But they're sold as just so pathetic and helpless and, like, almost like harmless, you know, just like.
Yeah. There's like no
they're,
threat.
They're
There's
very
no threat of
silly
these guys.
Fools.
Yeah.
That I think you like. You're endeared to them, even if you don't like them. Like, these people would be infuriating to be around, definitely.
Oh, yeah. Like, worst nightmare. Would not even have any kind of patience for them.
No. Like, the whole scene with the folding of the bread.
It's so funny. Just, like, it kept going.
Yeah.
And I'm like, this is like, well, fantastic.
Yeah, but you just fold this. He's like, yeah, but then you keep folding and it breaks
And it
apart.
Hangs over. It hangs over. It's too big. Mm-hmm. We need bigger bread. And they're like, we'll get you bigger bread.
Yeah, I will tell you, probably doing wedding catering was the most relatable thing to that.
Oh, okay.
Yes. Yeah. Almost invariably, you know, you talk with the bride and the groom, you have your plan, you have what they want, and then there's always some family member who's just like, well, we need this for this. And you're like, no, you don't, because that's not mm-hmm. what they wanted. And yeah, there are Nigel Tufnells out there who cannot grasp folding the meat for their miniature bread.
Do you think those trays were on his rider? And that's why he's so annoyed?
It's possible.
Also, like, the other stuff in on those trays, none of it looked good.
None of it looked good, no. And I was like, oh, goodness gracious. And when he picks up the olive, and he's like, this one, who's home? Nobody. Okay, now this one. He's like, it's a catastrophe. Yeah.
Yeah, it's great.
We probably don't have time to go through all of their songs, but you mentioned Big Bottom.
Yeah.
Clearly, this is a takeoff of Fat Bottom Girls by Queen.
Right.
Which I have, I think, already said on this show is, like, one of my favorite songs.
Yeah, you did.
What, yeah,
when did
right?
you say that? You said that recently. Freaks and Geeks, maybe?
Maybe it was a Freaks and Geeks episode, yeah.
Yeah.
It's absurd. It's insane. First of all, I don't know if you noticed this. I didn't notice this until this time around. All three of them are playing the bass.
I did not notice that.
They're all playing the bass, which makes it way funnier because it's the low end, right? It's the bottom end. And so they're like, we'll all play bass on this. But truly, these lyrics, they're abhorrent. And a lot of the songs really are. It just seems like they all got in a room and they're like, how many puns can we possibly make?
There's a song towards the end and the lyrics are, you're just 4 feet tall and you still have your baby teeth.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Which, if you go back and listen to a lot of rock songs are talking about, like, well, I mean, like the Beatles song, she was just 17, if you know what I mean.
You're right.
It's like, no, no, I don't know what you mean. Like, what are you talking about here?
Right.
But I like that they bring up all of those things, like the sexism, how the audience is all young white males, and it's funny. And like they do it in a way that if you were an artist going up on stage and singing these ridiculous songs that they're parodying, I can see you being really mad because you're like, yeah, they're not taking what I'm doing seriously. And they're saying that I'm this and that I'm that. But I think, you know, look in the mirror and maybe realize.
Yeah.
You are a joke, Ev. Right. So I just wanted to highlight the line that you brought up, which was, I think it's, I met her on Monday, but there's an important word in this line. Okay. I met her on Monday. Twas my lucky bun day. And it's the twas.
Yes.
That got me. Because yes. It's not just a stupid joke. They throw that word in and it's like, yes. Oh my God. Yeah.
Yeah. What was your favorite performance of theirs that we saw?
Well, the performance that I could relate to the most was when Nigel's talking about doing his solos. And he's doing this solo and then he's playing another guitar with his foot. And then he picks up a violin and he's playing the guitar with his violin.
Yeah.
Pauses. Slightly adjusts the tuning knob on the violin and then continues playing. Did you ever go to shows at like Cedar Beach?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. For those of you listening, Cedar Beach was a beach close by where we lived.
It is still a beach.
It is still a beach. It is still there. And it was through like the youth league or like a youth. I don't know. What do you call it?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Well, so there was this like organization that like put on different events for different, and you just like, you got in contact with them and you just like signed up for slots.
Oh, I just attended in the amphitheater.
Well, like, I played there.
Okay.
I like booked multiple shows there.
Okay.
And yeah, you literally just like got in contact with them and they're like, all right, these are the dates. When do you want to play? Wow. And you'd be like, well, like, what do I, and like, you just sign up. If people show up, they show up or they don't. We don't care. It doesn't make a difference to us. Yeah. And so I picked like three dates and they're like, okay, it's yours.
What was your band called? I don't think I've ever asked that.
I was in several bands. Jack Bandit was the biggest one that played for the longest. We recorded a full album.
What? Did I know this? I probably did. My memory is shot.
Maybe. Yeah. I'm not into self-promotion. You know what I mean? And then,
okay.
And then, well, I wasn't, I guess. As
I know,
person.
I'm just kidding. Yeah.
And then I was in a band called Cynthia Revenge.
Oh.
Not Cynthia's.
Cynthia.
Cynthia Revenge.
Got it.
I was in a band with our friend Brian. That band was called the Jessicas.
Wow.
In that band, our gimmick was we were Jessica 1, Jessica 2, and Jessica 3.
Now, did you always have the same role in the band?
I played the bass in most of the bands that I was in. After I got married, we were in a band called Decade.
Uh-huh.
And I played the drums in that band.
Wow.
And then in Cynthia Revenge, I played the guitar. But back to Spinal Tap.
Yeah.
It was like we took all of our frustrations out on the idea of performance by just being incredibly loud and angry. Like it was like a thrash screamo hardcore mm-hmm, band, mm-hmm. Three people.
Mm-hmm.
And the guitar that I played was missing two strings and I never tuned my guitar. That was the whole thing. And we would end each show. I think we probably only played like four shows. We would end each show with a completely improvised new song.
So it was a bunch of noise.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. And so watching him play the guitar with a violin, I was like, I've seen this before. And like, maybe I have done this before.
Wow.
Yeah. So I loved that. But yeah, I think probably their best song is probably, like I said, the opening song, I think is pretty good. Yeah. What about you?
Yeah. I got a kick out of the whole, oh my God. Well, the freeform jazz exploration. That really sent me flying.
Yeah. Yeah.
I was flying with that. And then the flower people, period.
Yeah. Yeah, that was good.
That was
I
really
love
good.
When they do that and then the camera goes into like kaleidoscope.
Yeah.
Mode.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I don't remember which song it was paired with, which you can, but the performance on stage when they're in like these egg-like containers, and you just see the blowtorch. They're trying to get Derek out. I think it was Derek who was locked in there.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was funny. That was really, really funny.
Yeah, the pod joke and the finding the stage joke, those are two where I'm like, this goes a little bit long for me.
No. No, the stage, finding the stage could have went on 10 more minutes for me.
Really?
I said, when I sent questions to you, I asked you, two scenes broke me in this movie, yeah. And I was curious if you knew which two.
The only one I could think of was Big Bottom and maybe Stonehenge.
Okay, no.
Okay.
The two scenes that broke me was the arm cross.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then finding the stage.
Wow. That's crazy. Because on each rewatch, I was like, oh, if Michelle hates this movie at this point, she's going to be like, and now we can't find the stage.
Oh, no. I thought this was so funny because the guy backstage, he's like,
yeah,
got to go left, got to go right. You got to jog 30, yeah, 30 steps. Feet. And then they do it and they find him again. I this was so
yeah, they come funny. Back to him again. He's like, yeah. You made a wrong turn.
This is great. Those two scenes were my favorite.
Do you know who Artie Fufkin from Polymer Records is?
I don't. It's
David Letterman's piano player.
What?
Yeah. Artie Fufkin. God. Polymer Records. I think it's so hard to say, man. It's really hard to say. But like the scene that really has me dying is Elvis's grave.
Oh man. Yeah.
Because, you know, they're like they've had some canceled shows and it's like, all right, okay. They go to Graceland and they're just like, wow, this is pretty depressing here. And so they start to sing Heartbreak Hotel. Mm-hmm. And at first it's like, oh, you know, this is like a nice, they're doing a nice little tribute to Elvis. But then they start trying to all sing and they're quibbling over what key it's in and they just completely lose sight of everything. Mm-hmm. And I think it's Derek is like, this really gives you perspective, huh? And David's like, yeah, too much perspective. This is depressing. But I just love that. I love that whole, because I feel like I've been in moments where people, you know, let the technical side of music kind of override the feeling of it. And it's like, yeah. Okay, can we just do this? You know?
Yeah. What brings tears? D minor?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yes. I'm very influenced by Bach and Mozart. So this is more like a mock piece.
Yeah.
And then I tear up.
You do?
I do. Yeah.
At the end?
Nigel quits. Ian quits first because he doesn't want to work with a woman.
Right.
Nigel quits because they're arguing in the studio and he doesn't understand why Janine has to be there. All okay, whatever. Playing their last show. And they realize they're like, we can't play like any of our songs without Nigel. And so that's when they do the jazz thing at the amusement park.
Mm-hmm.
And then Nigel shows up to tell them like, hey, Sex Farm Woman is number 5 in Japan. And then someone says, yeah, Spinal Tap's recording of Sex Farm Woman. As if it's like a standard, you know, an old classic standard that's been done hundreds of
years. Yeah.
You know, they're still kind of standoffish and cold towards each other. And then he looks at David and he's like, hey, David, do a good show. And I'm like, I tear up a little bit. And then when they're playing, David gestures for him to come back out on stage. And he like comes out on stage and everyone cheers and he puts his guitar on and he's like smiling and stuff. And I just tear up.
Wow. That's sweet, Seth.
And I'm like, why is Spinal Tap making me tear up right now?
Well, I think you could relate to it a little bit. And
yeah, it's just friendship, nice. Friendship, you know?
And working with someone.
Yeah. So it's silly to ask you if there's anything that we didn't talk about.
I mean, I just want to rattle off a couple of things.
Go for it. Military
time.
Yes.
What is that? Like 50 hours.
50 hours?
That's me. That was 20, me the whole time in England.
20 hours. It's 30 minutes.
Like, it's just that is me. A summer camp for pale young boys.
Yes.
Knighted for.
Mm-hmm.
I read basically everything I hear or read. Mm-hmm. I'm a real fish nut.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
No bones.
No more.
If I had to pick like another, like, oh, this is my favorite scene, it would definitely be Nigel talking about his guitars.
Yes.
Everything in that is just the sustain on this one. Listen. I don't hear anything. Well, you would if it was playing. I know that you didn't know anything about this going into it, but some of this stuff had to jump out at you. Like
nothing.
The numbers going up to 11? That didn't jump out to you?
No. That was funny. That is
referenced to death. You're going to see it now. You're going to see it. Trust me. You're going to at least see Turn It Up to 11. And maybe you just never knew that that was referencing this. Probably. But that's where this comes from.
Wow. The origin story.
The whole idea of like, we just need that extra push. It's like, okay. Yeah. Pretty good.
Pretty good.
Then the guitar where he's like, nobody, don't look at it. He's like, I was just pointing. He's like, well, don't point. It's like, all right, you've seen enough of this one. When I tweeted about this on Twitter, I said, this might be my favorite final line of a movie comedy, at least ever. At the end, Marty asks all the band members, what would you do if you weren't in rock and roll? Derek says, I'd work with children. David says, full-time dreamer. I can't even say these without laughing. Viv, the keyboardist, is like, I'd probably make a fool of myself if I couldn't go on stage and do it. The drummer, whose name I only remember, the last name is like Shrimpton or something.
Yes.
He's like, well, as long as there's sex and drugs, I guess I don't need the rock and roll part. Nigel is like, well, I guess I'd work out of a shop of some kind or do freelance selling, you know, like a salesman, like a haberdashery. What size do you wear, sir? I think we have that. No, we're all out. And Marty says, do you think you'd be happy doing that? And Nigel, completely serious, says, well, I don't know. What are the hours? And it's just...
It's great.
I mentioned at the top, this movie's edited by Kent Beta and Kim Sechrist. To me, that is the power of this movie. Like, knowing what to cut and what to keep in and what to put where. And just like, just ending on that joke and not like a big flashy Stonehenge joke, which like Stonehenge is funny, you know, especially if you listen to any kind of like heavy metal. There's always like, it's like heavy metal and nerds go like hand in hand, which has always been weird to me because they're like, we're having sex and doing drugs, but we're also singing about like druids. You know what I mean? Like, it's always been really odd to me.
Yeah.
But just knowing, no, this is the line to go out on. This is where we end the movie. Genius.
I agree. Yeah. I absolutely agree. It's funny, like this movie, I took the most amount of notes because I was just trying to catch the lines, but like it's so...
I didn't write everything down. Oh, Saucy Jack the Musical.
Yes. Yes, that made me... Jack the Ripper.
Saucy Jack.
Jack.
You're a haughty one. Saucy Jack.
Yeah. There's a moment where he like bends back playing and then he's got to be picked up.
Yes. Yeah. Because the move is you go down and you spin around on the floor. Right. Yes. But he's like too old to do it. But when he gets picked up, he still throws his hand up like, as if he did it. Yeah.
He owned it. There was a line where they meet, forgive me, I don't remember the name, but they're in the hotel. Mm-hmm. And they meet an executive, and the executive says, I'd love to stay and chat, but I got to go sit down and wait for our limo.
I don't remember that.
It's so serious. And I was like, I want to use that. Like it was when they get to the motel, they find out their show is canceled.
Yeah.
And they meet someone in that lobby. He's like in charge of, he's an important person. They're like a part of the other band.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, he's like the head of security or whatever. He's that. Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Because I'd love to stay and chat, but I have to go sit down and wait for a limo. Mm-hmm. That was really funny.
I do want to correct myself. I said that Nigel quit in the studio. He doesn't. He quits at the Air Force Base.
Right.
Because his radio guitar is picking up like plane departures and stuff like that. This is where we get Fred Willard as the go-between to the band. Yeah. And he's like... Just everything Fred Willard says and anytime is great. But when he's like, and would you play a few slow songs so that I can dance? It's like, oh my God. Like, I've been there before, like literally like playing a show and there's some old person who's like, hey, can you play a song by? And I'm like, no, because I don't learn other people's songs. Old man, sit down and shut up.
Wow.
So let's go to a segment of the show called What the Keck. So where we talk about what we would keep, what we would edit, and what we would cut. Do you want to go first?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
So as much as like I felt it was really hard to kind of cut something entirely from this movie, but I am cutting the security scene with a cucumber.
Yeah, yeah.
So that can go. I am actually going to edit down the bottom song sequence.
Wow. Okay.
And here's the thing. So we see that so early on.
Yeah.
And this might be where I felt it went too long because I didn't like get the flow of the movie yet.
Mm-hmm.
But I felt like all the other musical performances were not as long.
Sure. Sure.
So, and I would have liked more behind the scenes stuff. Like we could have edited that down and then I'm keeping the staircase scene.
Got it. Okay. All right.
Behind the stage, behind the.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. On that, on the bottoms thing, the payoff of that is just Christopher Guest shaking his butt as the two of them smack it.
Right.
And the double bass, the double necked bass, which is like, my God. Okay, so I am cutting. Oh man, yeah. I think I would cut honestly that whole finding the stage thing. I don't know why. I've just never found it funny, and it goes on for way too long. So it's like. And it's silly to even talk about cutting something in a movie that's 82 minutes and is for the most part just boom, 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 funny. I would edit down probably the pod song because that is a funny joke, especially like when they get to the part, like the breakdown where they're like, ah, na, 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 and then you hear the banging of the hammer. Like that's all funny. But for it being just one joke, I think it goes on a little bit too long. And then I'm keeping all of the. Just one-on-one interviews or like group interviews. And I would expand that, you know, just talk about how your drummers died.
Yes.
For however long. And
yes.
Just improvising with a group instead of like in the situations. To me, that's like some of the funniest stuff.
Yeah.
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 So we asked some friends on Twitter what they thought about the movie. And we did not get a lot of responses on this one, which kind of blew my mind because this is a movie that like everyone has seen. And we normally get like so many responses that it's like, I can't read all these. So maybe I got to start reading all of them. Maybe people are like,
hey, maybe it's because it's a holiday week.
Hey, maybe. You never know. But we did hear from.
Maybe they think it's a serious movie directed by Spike Lee.
Maybe they.
Film Twitter. I'm just kidding. I don't mean to insult you, Film Twitter. I know you're not like that.
We did hear from Felicia at Cinemaroni. She says, I actually like this film, but every single man, and I mean every single man I have ever dated, has been obsessed with this film and talked about it like it was cinema's greatest comedy. So I just can't separate this from my questionable taste in men.
Wow. Oh my gosh.
And I said to her that I was going to say, every man loves Spinal Tap and Felicia.
Yes. Yeah, that's another bumper sticker.
Honk if you love Spinal Tap slash Felicia.
Felicia, yeah.
Patrick Vicious at Alleyway Crew said, I use the none more black bit of dialogue in real life more often than one would think possible. And I do the same thing. If I'm ever looking at something that's black, I always say, how much more black could this be? And it's like, none. None more black. Devil Devil at Gormances.
Devil Devil?
Yeah. Now, this was in response to my tweet about spontaneous combustion, but I had to pull it because it was so funny. One time when I was still working as a theater usher, I was cleaning the venue and found the remains of someone's shoes. Literally just the soles of the shoes all crumbled. And then the hand on the face thinking emoji.
That's so funny.
So it's like, okay. Sure. Yeah. I mean, yeah. Maybe the movie knocked their socks off.
Right. Or they or really, like they during the movie, they're combusted. Right.
Yeah. He just disappeared in a flash of green light. It was a little green globule.
Yes, on the drums.
More like a stain, really. Oh, wow. I completely passed by all the facts of this movie, by the way. But oh,
what facts? You did the facts.
Well, just like the budget. The $2 million budget, which for the amount of footage that they shot, I don't even know how that's possible. 4.7 million box office return, which is, you know, you made your money back, but
yeah,
not a big... I guess people were confused. Seriously. Rob Reiner said, he was like, people were confused. Like, they thought it was a real band. Oh, they didn't know if it was supposed to be funny.
That's hysterical.
Yeah.
That's really funny. Did you tell me, I don't remember, do we know how long they took to film this?
I tried to find the filming, like the production days for this, and I couldn't find it.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So this has a 96 on Rotten Tomatoes. 3.9 on Letterboxd, 92 on Metacritic.
Okay.
Like I mentioned earlier, this is kind of in the Criterion Collection.
Mm-hmm.
This was included in the National Registry for the Library of Congress in 2002. Roger Ebert gave this 4 stars, and it's included in his list of great movies, which is like his version of the National mm-hmm. Film Registry.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, this movie's pretty well loved by Ebert and Felicia's ex-boyfriends.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Let's hear from some strangers on the internet in a segment called Half Star, Three Star, Five Star. Half star, three star, five star. So these are the reviews from Letterboxd.com. We start with a half star review, which is the lowest rating that you can give a movie. And we go all the way up to a 5-star review, which is the highest rating that you can give a movie. And do you have any requests for the half-star review?
Well, I was hoping you were going to read it as you were a member of Spinal Tap.
Okay. I have a question for you. Can you do Fran Drescher?
Can I do Fran Drescher? I don't think I can get her pitch.
Hmm.
You know what? I'm thinking of the nanny. Like it's true. Fran Drescher as the nanny.
And I feel like Fran Drescher is halfway to the nanny.
That's true.
Yeah.
Gosh. Yeah. Mr. Sheffield. No, it's not great. It's not. She's a tough one to do.
Yeah. I don't know if I can do this, man. Every week.
It's just a British accent.
I know. I must have watched a different movie than everyone else on here because I got absolutely nothing out of this. The funniest movie in the world got nothing more. Then slight exhale of air during one joke and absolute boredom for everything else out of me. Half star.
All right.
I was going for Nigel because he's very soft-spoken.
Very soft-spoken.
Yeah.
This person learned that this is not for them.
A slight exhale of air during one joke.
That's how I felt. I've been there.
Yeah, I get it.
I've been there.
3-star review says, I regret to say that Michael McKean is, in fact, hot in this movie. And again, this is probably somebody who only knows him from recent stuff or like Better Call Saul. And yeah.
I need to hold up. Yeah. Okay. What do I know him from?
Michael McKean?
Yeah. Coneheads.
Oh, Clue? Have you seen Clue?
You know, I don't think so.
Really? Okay.
Airheads.
Airheads and Coneheads.
I have a thing for the heads.
Mm-hmm. Brady Bunch movie? You have to have seen
Brady Bunch movie. Yes, that's it! That is it! Seth, this is a wrong time to say this, but I... thinking about it, and I meant to text you that we should have done the Brady Christmas movie.
Oh, I've never seen it.
Yes, you have. We've talked about it.
The Brady. Oh, the one with the building. I thought you meant these new.
No. And I've been meaning to ask you about that because you're the only other person in my life who has seen it, and I've talked to you about it.
Really funny.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, we can wake up at 6 a.m. one day.
Okay. I want to watch that again. Okay. Go ahead. I didn't, that derailed you, but that's really funny.
Okay. 5-star review says it's just very simple. Starts out with a quote from the movie. "You can't really dust for vomit. Honestly, might just be the funniest movie of the 20th century." All right. So, Michelle has a rating system, which is called a Schmovie Movie Film. We also rate the movie 1 through 5 stars and talk about if we would recommend it, final thoughts. And do you want to go first or do you want me to go first?
How about you go first?
Okay, I will go first. And this might shock you. You ready? Mm-hmm. I think that this is a Schmovie. Mm-hmm. Whoa, that didn't shock you. Okay.
No, it did shock. I wanted to have like a deep discussion about like, are mockumentaries schmovies? Because I was going back and forth with this.
I think that this one is.
You do? You like, yeah, okay. All right, continue.
This movie is genius in a lot of different ways, but I think the attitude of this movie is in the depths of movie making. And that's what I think of a schmovie as. You know
yes,
what I mean?
Yes, like, yeah. You know what a schmovie is. You yeah. know by now what it is. Yeah.
So I think that this is a schmovie.
Okay.
And I had this rated as 4 stars. I think that I'm going to go up to 4.5 stars. Mm-hmm. Rewatching it and seeing all the connective tissue and like how it does lay out a full story in order. Clearly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And just for being so funny. Yeah, 4.5 stars. And I definitely recommend this, especially if you're a fan of music. But even if you're not a fan of music, you know.
I think you have to be a fan of this kind of comedy. I would totally recommend this, but not to everyone. Because, like, I don't think my sister would appreciate this.
No?
No. It would be lost on her. She'd be like, this is really stupid. I'd be like, well, get out of here.
You never know. I mean, as I was watching this, I really, my wife said to me, she's like, do you think Michelle's going to like this? And I just turned to her. I was like, I have no idea ever. Like, that's the whole point of this thing. It's genuinely every week. I'm like, I don't know what is going to happen. There's sometimes where I'm like, it's going to be great. And so with this one, I was like, man, oof. Yeah. Anyway, what about you?
Well, to pull back the curtain a little bit, movie friend listeners, I told Seth that I'm no longer going to give him anything before we record.
Yep. Sometimes we'll share like notes or questions or things like that.
Or just like how I felt, or I'll be like, well, this was a tough one. Like I'm not doing that anymore because I think it adds to it. But all right. So I was struggling between a schmovie and a movie.
Yeah.
And I think this is like just the love child of a schmovie. And I originally had this rated 3.5, but I'm after today's discussion, it's a 4.2 for me.
Wow. Okay.
This was very funny. I very much enjoyed this and I would definitely recommend it, but to people who I know would appreciate it.
Right.
Yeah. Like, and if it was someone I just met, I'd be like, okay, what are we into? If we're like laughing about the same things, I'd be like, you should watch this if you haven't yet.
Got it. So did finding out that like it was improvised help you?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, definitely. Cool. Yeah. It's a good one. Thank you, Cosmo.
Yeah, Cosmo. I mean, honestly, I'm so glad we did this.
I know.
Instead of Blues Brothers.
Wait, you didn't share. I still have not shared. How did you get this whole way?
I don't know. Anyway.
What?
So November is over.
Yeah, November is over.
Crazy. Absolutely crazy.
Yeah. The weirdest one, I think.
Do you think this was the weirdest month for you?
Yeah.
It was kind of all over the place, huh?
I think that's why.
Yeah.
I think this was the weirdest one. And hey, maybe if someone's binging our show and they're like, actually, Michelle, you see that every month. But I feel like once I get to the end of the month, I'm like, that was a fun one.
Yeah.
Like, you know, listener month and 90s month.
The other thing is this also was like closest to like the most comedies, like, you know what I mean? Like Newsies is pretty comedic, you know?
You're right. Well, here we go. December.
So our theme for December is pretty simple. We're calling it Home for the Holidays. Mm-hmm. And the spin on it is you know, we were like, all right, are we going to do holiday movies? Are we not going to? And I was like, I don't want to, because I don't like them. And we talked about doing like documentaries for December, Doc-cember. That was, we talked about that for a long time. And
yeah,
then we decided we landed on it. And so what we're going to be doing is we're going to be inviting on different members of our, for the most part, like members of our family or like some friends or whatever, to talk about different Christmas movies that they like.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we're still covering some major pictures and one I haven't seen.
There's one that you haven't seen. There's one that I haven't seen.
That's right.
Yes. And that's, yeah, right. It's going to be like the main episodes, but there's going to be little episodes kind of sprinkled in and out. This next month is going to be crazy. There's a bunch of new releases that all got pushed because of the strike. Yeah, this is going to be a full, if you thought we were taking off for the holidays, we are doing the opposite of that.
Yeah, apparently we're not. So.
And who
you did. I know
whose idea was that? But anyway.
Yeah. I'm just kidding. Yeah, it'll be a fun one.
But it's our Christmas gift to you.
Yeah. Are you going to announce the movie we're watching next?
No, because I have to do the announcements first.
Oh, sorry.
Hey, if you want to be a Christmas gift to us, we'd love it if you'd rate and review the show. This is your final warning to enter into the $50 Visa gift card, guys. Come on. Stop screwing around.
I mean, you could just write like, you guys are great. Thanks.
Yeah. You could write, I'm doing this to enter into.
Please say that. I mean, rate 5 stars. Oh, put definitely. The 5 stars.
Yeah.
Throw a little emoji in there. Send me an emoji sentence.
You can also send us an email, moviefriendspodcast@gmail.com. We'd love to hear from you. You can also support the show, patreon.com/moviefriendspodcast. $5 a month gets you access to 4 additional shows. And we're getting ready to do some new stuff in the new year, and it's an exciting time. Patrons are going to be voting on episodes. Patrons are going to be voting on themes for entire months. So if you've been listening to the show and you're like, I like them, but I don't like the movies they cover, well, here is your opportunity to have a say. Okay, so next week with Sam, Michelle's sister, who wouldn't like Spinal Tap.
You're going to be a Reuben. You're going to be in a Reuben.
I'm going to be in a Reuben sandwich.
That's right. That's what we call it when someone's in the middle of us.
We are kicking off Home for the Holidays with a movie about someone who is home for the holidays. We're going to talk about Home Alone from 1990, directed by Chris Columbus. It's 103 minutes, and it's streaming on Disney Plus.
Woohoo.
And you've seen this before, right?
Yes, Seth, I have seen this before.
All right, very good. Cool.
Yeah, cool.
All right, well, thanks, Michelle.
Thanks, Seth. Thank you, Cosmo.
Thanks, Cosmo. Thank you, David St. Hubbins, the patron saint of quality footwear. And happy Thanksgiving, everybody. And we're heading into the holidays. It's all downhill from here. It's going to be my least favorite month, but hey. It's okay. I've had my picks for the entire year, so.
That's true. Yep. Welcome to cheer, y'all. Welcome to cheer.
Yep. You will see why everyone calls me the Grinch. Thanks very much for listening. Have a good one.
Movie Friends is produced by Seth Vargas and Michelle Rubenstein. Music by Anthony Picora. If you like the show, please subscribe and give us a rating. It really helps us find new friends. Thanks.